Welcome. Now we are going to be starting with the part two. It says minimum of 10 hazards. Then identify the hazards are taken from five hazard categories. Each column of risk assessment table has been completed for each of the identified hazard. What they are saying here is you have to write 10 hazard, which here I'm only giving us two. This is just for an example. And please ensure you don't copy what I write, because this alone made most people fail. You just copy and paste from the internet. Now, Bosch knows if you copy and paste, immediately they start to analyze with their computer. They know already if you copy and paste, because they've been through lots of links about Nebosch IGC. So when you copy, you put it in your notepad, you check it out, you write it in your own words, which means you paraphrase the word. You see, walk at height, falling of objects from height. Falling from objects from height, you can write it as tools falling from height. You can write it as objects used for walking, falling from height. You see, you are changing your words. It still means the same thing, but you are writing it in a way that you understand, that you can explain to someone and that person would understand you. You see, here it says hazard and hazard category and hazards. What is hazard category? You see, hazard category, I'm going to show us here. There are six types of hazard category. We have safety hazards, we have biological hazards, we have physical hazards, we have agronomics hazards, and we have chemical hazards, and final but not the least, workload hazard. These are just six. But when you talk of construction sites, which is workplace hazard, these are just generalized hazard. When you talk of workplace hazard, which is general term for workplace, you go to google.com, you write workplace hazards. You see, types of workplace hazard. Here it gives you six types, and here it gives you 10 types of hazards. As you can see, slip, trips and fall, electrical, fire, working in confined space, chemical hazard, biological hazard, asbestos and noise. You can see how easy it is. All you just need to do is open the link, and boom, you find everything there. But mind you, don't just, you know, as we used to do, we just copy and we paste it. No, you don't do that. You copy it, you put it in your notepad, then you analyze first. After analyzing, then you can come here together with your test book, together with your test books from your training center, what you've been taught, or the ones you've been taught on from your online class. So hazard category, we choose fall from height hazard. You see, something falling from height is an hazard, and it can be in category as well. You see, but from here, as a general hazard category, it's called safety hazard. But here we are talking of workplace hazard. You understand? So these are fall from height, you see. There are lots of examples here. Fall from tripping over who knows what. Who knows what means uneven floor surface, wet floor, loose cables, because you are working on site. So instead of writing slip, trip and fall, slip means somebody slipped. Trip means you tripped on maybe a cable or something, and fall means you fall. But the what we need is fall from height, because of the kind of example we are going to use. You see, walk at height, these are hazards. Walking at height, Walking at height is an hazard. Falling off objects or tools from height is an hazard. These are hazards. Then who might be harmed and how? Most of us write something like this. Workers undertaking work at height without safety harness. This does not show you understand what you are saying. You have to be specific in what you are doing. We have lots of workers. Okay, let's assume this is a construction site. We have welders, we have electricians, we have plumbers, we have carpenters, we have forklift drivers, we have crane operators, we have tilers, we have lots of workers, we have welders. So tell me, which worker are you talking about? Now you understand where we make mistake. So all you just need to do is be specific. Bricklayers undertaking maintenance work at height without safety harness. That is the person who will be harmed, because they asked you here who might be harmed. And how will they be harmed? You see, workers or visitors or people in the environment are at risk of injury from bruising, fracture, or worse. And it's worst case scenario, it can lead to death. Is this English correct? No. They said, how will they be harmed? You see, workers, visitors, and people in the environment are at risk of injury. And how will they get that injury? If the object falling from height, it's them. Any part of their body. You can see, maybe you are walking on site, then a hammer is falling from height, but you don't know. Immediately you hear somebody say something. Before you would react, it takes 3 seconds. Before you hear that noise, that's 1 second. Before you look up to determine where the object is falling from, it becomes 2. Then for you to move your body, is, you see, that's 3 seconds rule. So let's assume it's a saw that's falling down. A saw is sharp, so when you see it, you judge it might give you bruise on your hand. You see, that's one. If it's an hammer or a brick that is broken, is coming from up, it might hit you on your head, then that's possible. It can lead to death, it can give you injury, things like that. You see, there are lots of. So, what are you already doing to prevent that thing? The other thing you're already doing, some of us don't understand what they mean by what are you already doing. All workers must be trained for awareness about the incident and how to avoid reoccurrence in future. If you notice this is happening, okay, immediately you finish your duty. You see, most of us will write, stop the work. Abibi, let's be realistic. Okay, you gave a contract out worth $200 million. And they told you, how long do you think you can finish this? Or you tell them, okay, 1 year, I'll finish. Do you know if you lose 1 hour, you are wasting time and you are becoming late on submitting that project, which your clients might charge you to cut for not meeting up? Then, inspection of work area must be done prior, during, and after carrying out daily activities. You see, most guys, when they close, they just eat things, they throw away the nylon, they eat banana, they throw away the... All these things, you are the one causing the problem. You see, poor housekeeping happens on most construction sites. That is why before they start the work, you have to have somebody. You see that you go there as a safety officer, to check around if it's okay. If it's not, you call the housekeeping to come and take care of it. When they are working, you go around as well, and after daily activities. First aid kit must be provided at every work location. Because of this kind of bruises and cuts and so on and so forth, it's easier to render first aid. Just clean the wound. If it's small, then do. If it's more, before the emergency units arrive, then you have to render first aid. Then provide adequate supervision for workers. What adequate supervision? You see the way people work, most especially all the manpower, the laborers on site. If the safety officer is not there, they just behave the way they like. They go up without harness. They walk around without their helmet. Some even put their helmet, their armpits. You see, all these things. If there's a supervisor, somebody there ensuring that they adhere to safety, and if they don't, they face disciplinary action. You see, everybody will buckle up. Everybody will work the way they are supposed to. This is why it's good for every one of us to understand what we are doing. So what further controls or actions are required? This, they are asking for immediate control, medium control, and long-term control. What are your plans? What are the things you plan now to happen, the ones that will happen in 1 week and the ones that will happen later in 1 month? You see, provide training on how to use and maintain tools. That's immediately they finish their duty. Everybody come here. You cannot stop the work. You just correct that person. Then when they finish their duty, you bring everybody together within maybe 30 minutes and explain to them. Habibi, my friend, I found so thing happen. I found this happen. Please don't let this repeat itself. This is how to use these tools. This is how to use these tools. But that is not practical. Because they just finished their duty, all their mind, they want to go. So they only tell you, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. They are not listening. So it has to be before they start their daily duty. You have to take two bus stops. You have to take, you know, safety training before they start. That is very practical. Everybody will remember what you tell them. Because if you catch them on duty, then they will be okay. But after the duty, everyone is tired. They will not listen. So provision of safety net on site where worker tight is required. You see, there are some contracts that have, you know, there are some projects that have 15, 20, 30-story building. So how do you ensure that things falling from height does not injure people? You have to put safety nets. Safety nets have two types. There are some with very big hole. There are some with very small hole. Those small holes are the ones that hold debris, you know, when there is reconstruction going on and they are breaking bricks, you know, the debris will fall down. And by mistake, the ones a little big, more bigger that can injure someone can fall. Those ones can be held with the ones with the big, you know, big space. But the smaller ones can hold more sands. Sands, concrete, cements, and so on and so forth. It can hold that. And at the end of the day, it will be cleaned. So those are between 1 day and 1 week. And you provide PPE, provide personal protective equipment for people within 2 days. Today you find them not using it. Where is your safety harness? They don't find it. Arbab not give me, or supervisor tell me it's not available. You have to tell them, tomorrow, I don't want to see you on this site without the PPE. Then you reach to their supervisor as well. So, using of mobile elevating work platform, MEWP, you've seen most of all this they use in lifting people at height. That is what they use in doing all these traffic lights on the highway. It's not possible for you to put a ladder. So those MEWP are what will extend the person to finish the work. This is not something very easy to get because, you know, the price is a little bit expensive. So it's something you plan, get approval from this and that before you can get. Those are long time. That is why you find in the time scale, this one is 1 day, this one is 1 week, this one is 2 days, and this one is 1 month. Who are the people responsible for that job title? You see, the safety manager and the supervisor are responsible for 1, 2, 3. This is 1, 2, 3. And the site manager and supervisor are responsible for 4. Because this one needs to go through lots of, you know, lots of approval, sign this, sign that, before they can rent or buy something like this. Then let's go to the second one, which is the confined space. This is the hazard category, confined space hazard. You can see here, working in confined space, places that are mostly enclosed and can become dangerous locations to work. Chambers, tanks, silos. You see why we use confined space. This shows you understand what you are saying. We did not use working in tanks. No. It might not be on tanks, it might be drainage that is covered, you know, it might be excavation that is covered, it might be you know, a passageway from one place to another. Silos, vat pits, trenches, sewer, drainage, dutch work, and unventilated or poorly ventilated rooms can increase risk of death or serious injury. Now you understand. So we go back to our checklist. You see, what are the hazards? Using of damaged welding cable in a confined space and working without respiratory equipment in a confined space. You see? All this shows you know what you are doing. Using of damaged welding cable in a confined space. You are going inside somewhere that, you know, the oxygen level is low and you did not take care of this thing. This can lead to electrocution. You understand me? When you touch an iron and you don't know why you're working because you have only limited space. So immediately you turn, your hand touches iron or something, then you get electrocuted. Who is going to help you? How are you going to survive it? So who might be harmed and how? You see, welder working in a confined space could suffer smoke inhalation and pass out, which is one. Welder is at risk of health threats like suffocation and electrocution. Which one do you think is better from these two? Suffocation and electrocution and suffer smoke inhalation and pass out. This English is not, it's okay, but not enough to give you very good scores. So welder is at risk of health threats like suffocation. Suffocation includes the inhalation of gas and you are trying to breathe, you cannot breathe, you find it hard to breathe. And electrocution, in case your hand touch something with electric. So what are the things you are doing to prevent this? You see, proper inspection of welding cables before, during, and after work activities. Welding helmets. Welding helmets with side shield. You see, this will shield you from the UV lights. The radiation is ultraviolet light. You don't write UV, you write ultraviolet particles, hot slab, and chemical bonds. And provide respirators to protect workers from fumes and oxide caused through welding process. You see, because you are going in a confined space, you don't just put a nose mask. You use RPE, respective equipment, that has filter. Now, when you put your nose in it, those fumes will not be able to come in. It will filter it. You only breathe in the oxygen that is there. Okay? Then, what you are doing for the long time and short time, you see, training workers about hazard that occur during welding activities in confined space. So before they go in, the day they are on site, you explain to them, okay, these are the welding activities you do, these are the pros, these are the cons of this. So they will understand that, okay, when I'm doing this work, this might happen, this might happen. And guide the worker on preventive and control measure of the risk associated with welding. When they are coming to get their permits to work, it's already listed in the permit to work, the hazards and the risk assessment done. Then close monitoring and competent supervision. You know, it's a confined space. It's not something you just rush in and rush out. You have to take your time, you have to squeeze, you have to walk, you have to bend, and so on and so on. You might sometimes have poor posture because it's confined space, it's not enough space. But how do you monitor? You can monitor by sending in drone. You will know what drone is, right? You can send in a video camera. You can send video camera. Then you can go there physically if it's enough for two people. And you ensure that certified first aiders are available. And first aid equipment is available inside that confined space. In case of bruises or cuts, he or she can attend to his or herself before help arrives. Then, proper ventilation of the area in the place by providing portable air conditioning unit. You know, when they are working, it will be hot. There's no space for enough oxygen to come in. So you give them a portable air condition. It might be through a pipe that will be there to, you know, give them oxygen. When they feel hot or very, they can move closer a bit, then they feel cold and back to work again. Then work area must be isolated with barricaded and adequate signs. You see, you must barricade that area. So maybe children are walking by, then you don't just know how they got inside. It becomes a problem. If anything happened to that child, if you don't know a child entered that place, or somebody does not have any idea there's a confined space entry this way, it's just trying to look inside without knowing there's issues inside. And people walking there already put on their respiratory protective equipment. Immediately he goes there without the RPA, you know what's going to happen. All that 3 seconds is gone. Now, wear appropriate PPE for welding tasks such as welding glove, apron, face shield, and respiratory protector, which I've explained. Then this is the most of all. You see, provision of panic button or alarm in every confined space. You see, people working in oil and gas industry face lots of problems from chemicals, most especially H2S. H2S is a chemical, it's a killer gas. I won't say chemical gas, a killer gas. Under 30 seconds, you are gone if you don't find help. Because you won't know. The more you try to struggle, the more easier it takes you out. So if something like this happens, maybe while drilling in the confined space, then by mistake you puncture a pipe or an underground service that you don't know about, then gas or fume come outside. You see, before you say, somebody here outside, it might take time. So all you just need to do is, your mobile phone is called SOS for emergency. It's panic button like a button. All you just need to do is press that button. It might be silence, it might be loud, it might be a beacon light would come up, or they hear the sound that, hey, there's a problem at this conference space. Somebody go there with the force leader. You see, some they attach, a shackle to your clothes, that if there's any problem, they pull you out. This shows the understanding of your work. It shows you know what you are doing. And you understand why we put safety officer, site manager, people who are responsible for taking out all this. Number one, number two, number three, we included them. So, one more thing. Do not forget to include your learner number, your learner name, and the pages. You have to include all this. Some of you copy from somebody. You see, copy the name and copy the learning number. Because they help you by explaining to you, does not mean you copy their name and learner number, okay? Thank you very much for listening. And this is the end of part two. I hope if you would like to continue more to understand the part 3 and part 4, you can still click on the link below. You will find them there. And thank you very much for your listening. I love you guys and have a lovely day ahead. Ciao.